Scheduled to be executed less than 8 hours from now. But just hours ago, lawyers for Georgia inmate Troy Davis filed a new request to block the execution. His supporters say there is not enough evidence for him to be put to death. Davis was convicted of killing police officer Mark McPhail in 1989. He is set to die by lethal injection at 7 p.m. Eastern. Here's how Davis is likely to spend his final hours. From now until 3 p.m., he is allowed to meet with family, friends, clergy members, and his attorneys. And then he's scheduled for a routine physical exam. At 4 p.m. Eastern, Davis will be offered his last meal. Prison officials say he did not request anything special. At 5 p.m., he'll have a chance to record a final statement. And then 1 hour before the execution, Davis will be offered a sedative. Well, the prosecution in the Troy Davis case says that he has no doubt that Davis is guilty. CNN's David Mattingly asked former DA Spencer Lawton about the allegations that witnesses were coerced.
Do you think there's any credibility in their claims that they were intimidated by police to make false statements?
No. No, I don't. I know the police involved. I know they're professional. I know them individually and personally, and I can vouch for the character and the professionalism of any one of them.
But an editorial in today's New York Times says grievous errors were committed by the police in the Davis case. Now, joining us to talk about that is Mike Brooks. He's a law enforcement analyst with our sister network, HLN. He's also a law enforcement contributor for In Session on True TV. Mike, thanks for joining us. First of all, according to the New York Times editorial here, there are a number of serious mistakes that were made. First, the paper says that Savannah police reenacted the crime with four of the people together who turned out to be eyewitnesses. Take us through how this identification process is supposed to work. What is wrong with that?
Well, Suzanne, first of all, I don't know whether they were asked, okay, where were you? Show us where you were when this crime was committed, or if law enforcement recreated it in front of them as they stood by and watched. Usually, sometimes if I'm an officer, I will bring one at a time in and say, okay, where were you standing? What did you see? What did you hear? And just do one at a time and not all of them together.
Well, what's the problem with having them all together?
Because you don't want one to hear the story of the other, and then is one then to say, oh yeah, that's what I saw. If there was any doubt of what they possibly saw when the crime was being committed.
Okay, Mike, so secondly, they say the police allegedly showed some of the witnesses Davis's photo even before the lineup. So how would that impact how they recall things if they see his picture before the lineup?
Right, if there were sometimes officers or detectives will show a victim or a witness a photo lineup with usually at least six or possibly nine pictures, and they will make their initial identification and then take them in for a physical lineup. You know, in the Metropolitan Police Department in Washington, D.C., they had a unit, the lineup unit, Suzanne, that was dedicated just to lineups, and they would bring people in, say, on September 21st, 2011, you were the victim of or a witness to a shooting. Can you identify anyone in this lineup that was involved in this offense? And they would go up and down, and sometimes they would say it would be number one, or was it number two? But prior to that, you have a defense attorney and a prosecutor there to review that lineup, and they can make their objections. Was this done in this case?
Right.
I don't know if it was or not.
And third, they say that Davis's lineup picture was set apart and had a different background than the other photos. Why would they do that? Is that proper?
Well, it depends on the photos that they had available to them to do a photo array or a photo lineup. But usually you're trying to get photos, Suzanne, that are similar, because you don't want to have, five white guys and one African-American in a photo lineup. You don't want to have anything that stands out. But if that were the case, they should have objected to this photo lineup and tried to have it thrown out in a pretrial hearing on evidence. And apparently that was not done either.
All right. Well, all of this clearly they bring up as being egregious errors in this case. In addition to those practices, they say that six of those eyewitnesses were threatened that if they didn't identify Troy Davis, that that they would have bad things happen to them. So we know that clearly that is a practice that is not legitimate and was used in this case. Mike Brooks, thank you so much. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Suzanne.
The Georgia Board of Pardons and Paroles today refused to reconsider its decision on the Troy Davis case. The board refused his request for clemency yesterday. Here's a profile of the five people who made that final decision on Davis's fate. James Donald, he's chairman of the board. He's a former corrections commissioner who was appointed by the former governor, Sonny Perdue. He was elected chairman by the other board members in 2010. The vice chairman is Albert Murray. He was also appointed by Governor Perdue. He previously served as commissioner of the Department of Juvenile Justice. Gail Buckner, also a Perdue appointee. She was a special agent with the Georgia Bureau of Investigation. Robert Keller was appointed by Governor Perdue as well. He's a former chairman of the Prosecuting Attorneys Council of Georgia. And Terry Bernard, another Perdue appointee. He served almost 16 years in the Georgia House of Representatives. Well, next hour, we're going to hear from a man who says prison is hell, death row is torture, and he should know. Randy Steidel spent 12 years on death row before he was exonerated.